If they ran into the hills to hide, which many women did, the population control police would begin arresting their relatives. They would turn off the electricity and water to the parental home. They would fire the parents or the husband from their jobs. They would keep the pressure on, keep escalating the pressure until the poor women who were in hiding felt they had no choice but to come out and sacrifice the life of their unborn child in order to save their family from utter rack and ruin.
Hello, everyone. I'm Dr. Jennifer Roback Morse, founder and president of the Ruth Institute. And today I'm delighted and excited to have with me my guest, Dr. Steve Mosher. Actually, he's not a doctor. He should be a doctor, but he's not. And I'm going to let him tell you a little bit about that story. Steve Mosher, tell people, say hi to the Ruth Institute viewers and tell them a little bit about your experiences at Stanford, just to get things started.
Well, I'm glad to be here with you and to be here with all the Ruth Institute viewers. You do great work, and it's badly needed in this day and age when we seem to have forgotten certain fundamentals about who we are and where we're going. The sad thing is that I'm almost a doctor twice. You know, I completed all the coursework and the general examinations for a PhD in the biological field. And then I switched to anthropology and completed all the coursework, the general examinations, and my dissertation for a PhD in cultural anthropology. And the Stanford University professorate, very angry at what I had been writing and publishing about what was happening in human rights in China, refused to read it. So yeah, I'm in the rare position of being ABD twice, all but doctorate twice. So close and yet so far.
And in my mind, I have promoted you to full-fledged Dr. Mosher. But what were they so upset about? First of all, when did this take place, and what were they so upset about that you were writing?
Well, I was the first American social scientist allowed into that country that is on everyone's minds these days, because it is the source of the pandemic that has the world in a kind of grip of terror right now. The country, of course, is China. And China, sadly, under the misrule of the Chinese Communist Party, has been unleashing deadly campaigns against its own people and against some of its neighboring countries for a long, long time. The Chinese Communist Party came to power in 1949. In 1979, I became the first American social scientist on the ground in China to do research, 30 years after the Communist Revolution. And I found the situation, in many respects, had not improved. The people's material lives had not improved. They were all working for what they called the big landlord. The Chinese Communist Party had come into my commune, what was called a people's commune in those days, and had basically executed all of the landlords, small landholders mostly, and then set itself up under the commune system as what the peasants called the big landlord, and took most of what they had, most of what they created, most of what they produced was taken by the state and then resold. So they were very unhappy with the state, as they told me over time. And they were even more unhappier in March of 1980 when the one-child policy began, because the Communist Party officials went door to door in my commune and found out who was pregnant with second, third, fourth, higher order children, and ordered them to come to meetings. You didn't dare refuse such an invitation from the Chinese Communist Party. And they were all told they must get abortions because they were violating the new one-child policy. Many of these women had gotten pregnant 3, 6, even 9 months before. It didn't matter. The law, the one-child policy, was to be applied ex post facto, after the fact. And these women, the ones who refused, were arrested. They were locked up, and they were subject to morning-to-night brainwashing sessions. The Chinese Communist Party calls them study sessions. You study until your opinions match perfectly with the current party line, and then you do what the party tells you. And they were all taken at the end of the day to a local medical clinic, and they were all given abortions, forced abortions, which began with lethal injections into the womb to kill their unborn children. Many of these women, as I mentioned, were 7, 8, 9 months along. Some were very close to giving birth. And after that, after the poison shot had been administered, they were then given cesarean section abortions. Abortion by cesarean section was something new in the world, I think, at that time. And I was present in the operating room when they were giving these lethal injections and delivering the now dead or dying babies by cesarean section. I mean, I was 6 feet away from the operating table, standing horrified. And, you know, it was, as you can imagine, it was a horrible thing to witness. It was even more horrible for the women who were being forced to undergo it. They were broken, not just in body, but in spirit, after they were forced to undergo an abortion of a baby they had longed for, that had been created and, you know, in love with their husbands 7, 8, 9 months before. And now they were suddenly mothers of a dead son or mothers of a dead daughter. And suicide rates went up in China and were still high 3 decades later. A lot of young women decided if they could not save the life of their child, they would end their own lives. And they did so by drinking poison and other gruesome means.
Wow. So you saw this in 1980, early 80s, is when this began and when you saw this. And so were you at that time, were you involved in pro-life activities at all? Was this was this something new for you?
No, I'd never really thought about the life issue. I was a young man at Stanford University. I was teaching at the University of California at Berkeley, to the extent that I thought of the question of when life begins at all, or thought of the question of abortion. I thought of it as a woman's issue. It certainly wasn't, you know, a very comfortable position for a young man to take, to not be concerned about the consequences of sexual behavior. But when I was in the operating room witnessing the death of these tiny sons of Adam and tiny daughters of Eve, it crystallized in my mind the existence of evil. And that was the beginning of my trip back to finding the faith and finding God, actually, because I had believed and had told many people in the course of my then young life that absolute evil didn't exist, that ethics were situational. It all depended upon the situation, what you might want to do, that morals were relative. There was no absolute evil, no absolute good. Everything was shades of gray. And suddenly I was confronted with what was obviously an absolute pitch black, dark, bottomless pit of evil. I became pro-life, and I
just like that,
aware of the existence of evil. Yeah, instantaneously. There was no question in my mind, never has been, that an abortion kills a living, breathing human being who is just as deserving of life as those of us who are bigger and stronger and capable of defending ourselves. All of this, of course, fell on deaf ears at Stanford, because I went back and I told my dissertation committee what I had seen in China, the forced abortion of women in the third trimester of pregnancy, among other things, forced sterilization, forced contraception, massive human rights violations in various areas. And I'll never forget the chairman of my dissertation committee, now deceased, said to me, "Well, I'm personally opposed to forced abortion in the third trimester of pregnancy, but," he said, "it's no worse than President Reagan denying poor women federal funding for their abortions." And I sat there aghast and listened.
Whoa.
The worst case of moral equivalence I have ever heard in my entire life, either
illogical,
then or now.
Completely
because
illogical.
He was comparing the killing of a perfectly healthy baby nearly at birth with the principled refusal of a pro-life president to pay for the killing of that same child. How can those two things possibly be equivalent? Especially because the women in China were being denied a choice.
Right.
I mean, it seemed to me that whether you were pro-life or pro-choice, that you would all the same oppose forced abortion, because these women were being denied both of life, the life of their unborn child, and a choice in the matter. So can't we all come together? Well, no, the Stanford professor couldn't come together. I found another member of my dissertation committee a little more honest about his feelings. He, of course, no longer in this world, said to me, "Well, I know that China commits serious human rights violations, but, you know, I want to go to China next year and do research. And if I'm associated with you, I won't be allowed to do that. So I'm going to sever our relationship.
Wow.
At least had the virtue of being honest.
Yes, yes. Now, there are so many things taking place just in this incident, which took place in what,
1980, 81, yeah.
Okay, is when that took place. Okay, that thing from 40 years ago encapsulates what we've been dealing with ever since, which is China committing grotesque abuses and people in the West either turning a blind eye because they have some personal interest in wanting to continue to do business with China.
The China coronavirus pandemic makes it clear that there's more to the China price than the upfront cost. We are now paying a cost of trillions and trillions of dollars in lost income in the world's economy, which we must add to the China price. And when you add the cost of the pandemic to the China price, those made in China goods no longer seem quite so cheap, do they?
Yeah, exactly, exactly. So this was the end of you getting a PhD in anthropology from Stanford, back to our original story, and charted you off on a very different life course. Just tell us just a little bit about what you did next, and then we'll come back to China a little bit more.
Well, I started writing books, and I was lecturing around the country. I found, I went to Princeton, I went to Yale, I went to major universities and lectured on the human rights situation in China. I wrote books, wrote articles. But in 1985, I got a call from, and that was the year, by the way, that Stanford finally decided that they weren't not under any circumstances going to give me a PhD. I had appealed the original decision of the anthropology department to the president of the university. He took 4 years to decide whether or not I would be allowed to continue at Stanford and get a PhD. And he finally wrote me in 1985 and said, we don't know whether the charges made against you by the Chinese Communist Party are true or not. China had made a large number of charges against me. They'd accused me of spying. They'd accused me of publishing articles to attack the Chinese people. Actually, I was publishing articles to attack the Chinese Communist Party and defend the Chinese people, but that, you know, lying is second nature to them, so they lied. So the president of the university said, we don't know whether the charges made by the Chinese Communist Party against you are true or not, but there's been a gradual erosion of trust between you and the university, which makes it impossible for you to continue here. So until I got that letter, my life was sort of on hold because I was under the naive view that the truth would win out, that all that is currently hidden would one day come to light, and these people of generally progressive sentiments at Stanford would eventually see that that maybe the Chinese Communist Party was engaging in lies and deceit where I was concerned. But they didn't. They didn't.
Right.
They
right.
were more
right.
interested to preserve their ties to China, as many people have proven to be interested in doing over the last few decades. So in 1985, after I received that letter, I was thinking about what I might want to do. I got a call from a Catholic priest. Now, this was the first Catholic priest I had ever spoken with in my entire life. His name was Father Paul Marx.
Said, I know what you mean.
Marx did. He said, I'm holding a conference in Washington, D.C., and I'd like you to come and tell us, what's happening in China and recount your story of the one-child policy. And I said, I would be happy to do so, because no one else was listening. I had been to visit the National Organization of Women. And I had talked to the head of the National Organization of Women, and I had told her the same thing that I just told you. And that was, look, China is forcing women to have abortions in the second, third trimester pregnancy. Women in China are being denied a choice. Can we join together and condemn this? And I'll never forget what she said to me, sounding a lot like my advisor at Stanford. She said, well, I'm personally opposed to forced abortion. But after all, China does have a population problem. Very clearly the priorities of the leader of the National Organization of Women laid out for everyone to see. She was more concerned about overpopulation, whatever that is. Don't ask me because I don't know. We don't have it. We don't suffer from it. We never will. She's more concerned about something called overpopulation than she was concerned about the right of women to choose. Right. And I think that was another, eye-opening moment for me, because I saw that population control was driving not just what was happening in China, but a lot of what was happening around the world in terms of these assaults on women and families and unborn children.
Right. So then you went off to Father Marx's conference, and the rest is history.
Went to Father Marx's conference. He said, I can't afford to pay you, but you can bring a few of your books and maybe you'll sell some. That wasn't the best offer I'd ever had. And I found myself in the midst of, a wonderful group of thousands of people who were engaged in a civil rights struggle that for which they would receive very little reward in this world, because they were fighting on behalf of the unborn who could not speak for themselves, who could not defend themselves. And they were warm, caring, loving people. And over time, I decided I wanted to be like them. And I was already pro-life. And so it was only a short step to joining the pro-life movement and joining Father Marx in his pro-life work. But think about what I had been through. I had been rejected by academe, which was more interested in defending its relationship with the People's Republic of China than defending academic freedom. That was a wake-up call. That was a moment. And then I had visited with progressives, including women who claimed to be interested in defending a woman's right to choose, and found out they weren't. They were more interested in the state's rights to choose how many people would live within their borders and use whatever means possible to achieve that goal. So I was almost by default, I was left with the deplorables.
Yeah, the crazy pro-life people. There you were. And you've been probably pro-life ever since.
I have been. My wife and I have tried to live our pro-life sentiments. That's why we wound up with 9 children. And let's see, I think we have 9 grandchildren, but we're hoping to be into double digits soon. Population control violates the natural right of couples to decide for themselves the number and spacing of their children. This is no business of governments. It is the natural right of couples. And when you have a population control program as flagrant as China's, where women were actually arrested for the crime of being pregnant, and I have arrest warrant, copies of arrest warrants, where on the form, in the block where you write the crime for which the woman is being arrested, is written the words huayun, which means pregnant in Chinese. So women are arrested for the crime of being pregnant without permission. Everybody, I think, should see that as a gross violation of human rights. And then locking up women and holding them, incarcerating them until you get permission to perform an abortion, that's coercion. And then we have the cases of women actually being dragged by force into abortion clinics, tied down on operating tables, and forcibly aborted. I don't know anyone who, in their right mind, who wouldn't be opposed to that sort of thing. But even if you're talking about, say, Indonesia a few years ago, where as part of their sterilization campaign, they were sending the military door to door to bring in women who had 3 children to be sterilized, to have their tubes tied. That's a gross violation of human rights. A few years ago in Peru, we had the UN Population Fund serving as the technical secretary of President Fujimori's sterilization campaign, under the terms of which 300,000 women were sterilized, often against their will and without their consent. And it turns out, we were heavily involved in exposing the campaign. It turns out that all the victims of the sterilization campaign were not the descendants of Francisco Pizarro, who lived in Lima. They were the Quechua-speaking descendants of the Incas who lived in the high Andes, the Altiplano. They were being disproportionately targeted for sterilization. Why? Because they were poor. And the methods used were things like, we're going to deny your children medical care unless you come in for a tubal ligation, senora, or we're going to deny you medical care unless you agree to a tubal ligation, or we're going to take you off a nutritional supplement program, even though that 2 pounds of protein powder that we give you every month prevents your child from developing, you know, a protein deficiency, unless you come in for tubal ligation. So there were various means used, not so much out and out force as you see in China, but coercion nonetheless, and a violation of human rights as well. There are still legal cases pending in Peru 20 years later against former President Fujimori and his henchmen for carrying out this campaign against women. And this was funded and supported by the UN Population Fund, which, get this, they brought in to serve as advisors for the sterilization campaign. They brought in people from China's family planning organization to teach them how to do it right.
Oh my golly. And you know, I read somewhere that at its height, the Chinese one child policy, they had what they call birth control police. Is that what they were called? Is that literally what they were called?
The Women's Federation, which was the women's arm of the Chinese Communist Party, was turned into a population control police. These were women who went door to door, tracking women every month to make sure they had not gotten pregnant without permission. Right. If they discovered that a woman had gotten pregnant without permission and was threatening to violate the policy, they would then embark upon that process that we talked about. They'd first be visited by one official, then by five officials, and then maybe by 10 officials if they still refused to take it off by force. They'd be locked up. If they ran into the hills to hide, which many women did, the population control police would begin arresting their relatives. They would arrest their brothers and sisters. They would arrest their husbands, their parents. They would turn off the electricity and water to the parental home. They would fire the parents or the husband from their jobs. They would keep the pressure on, keep escalating the pressure until the poor women who were in hiding felt they had no choice but to come out and sacrifice the life of their unborn child in order to save their family from utter rack and ruin. They were tearing down houses.
Yes. Rich, I've seen those photos of the wrecking ball coming through and tearing down a house in full view of all the neighbors, of course, to put terror into the entire neighborhood, not just that one family that had that happen to them.
And how you say that in Chinese is you kill the chicken to warn the monkey. There's another Chinese saying that you kill one to warn the hundred.
Yes.
I mean, that's the same thing, to put the fear of God, you know, to...
not God, not the fear of God, the fear of the Chinese Communist Party.
Right,
let's be clear.
In our civilization, we would say, we would use the word God. They would not use that term.
Right. But it shows the position that the CCP has. They are God. You know,
right.
they have absolute power, and they are not a good, loving, kind, personal God either. You know, this is no, hippie Jesus over there we're talking about. We're talking about the longest, deepest arm of the state. And to me, one of the most shocking things about this whole sequence of events is how much the global elites support population control and support the kind of things that you're describing. I've gotten to the point where I no longer talk about left and right or Democrat and Republican because it's so widespread. You know, the Rockefellers, you wouldn't say the Rockefellers were Marxists, but they were the core, the heart, the beginning, the jump start of population control. And they had their, you know, they had their little reasons for why they were doing that. And it wasn't, you know, wasn't anything you would think of as Marxist-Leninist. It's a common desire, though, for power. And I'm talking about, this is totalitarian kind of power. When a state can make a woman post her menstrual period in a public place, I mean, this is another thing that I'm told that they used to do, that in your workplace there'd be a chart and women were required to put down the date of their menstrual period in public so everybody would know, did she miss her period? You know, come on, people. Come on. This is not
There was that kind of social pressure used very effectively by the Chinese Communist Party, because if one person on your factory floor violated the one-child policy, then everybody would be denied their bonus. The party officials in charge would not be promoted. They might be demoted. They wouldn't receive commendations for meeting their population control target, their birth target. They would receive criticism. They'd have a letter put in their record. They might be transferred and demoted. So there was a lot of pressure, social pressure, both on the officials in charge and on your peers in the workplace who would join together to criticize you if you threatened to have an overquota child, because they too would suffer under the principle of collective punishment that the Chinese Communist Party, like all totalitarians, uses very effectively. They don't punish the individual only. They publish the individual's family. They publish their local community, the local society, to generate peer pressure on nonconformists to conform with what the party is demanding of them. But population control is always a case of the haves targeting the have-nots. When it began in the United States, of course, it was the generally the white Anglo-Saxon Protestants living in the Northeast who believed that there were far too many of these Irish Catholics and Italian Catholics and so forth coming into the country, and they were having far too many children. And so the initial effort of even Margaret Sanger was to target the immigrant neighborhoods, which were relatively poor because they were immigrants, but had relatively large numbers of children. And that's where the efforts remain today. It is a question of, they believe that you can eliminate poverty by eliminating the children of the poor. And you cannot do that. That is a failed theory. We know how to eliminate poverty. If you have the rule of law, if you have respect for property rights, if you have a government that's largely answerable to the people, if you have freedom of speech, freedom of assembly, freedom of association, that you can generally get an economy jump-started off the ground and join the ranks of the developed nations in 20 or 30 years. That's how it's done. You don't become a wealthy country by eliminating people. People are the ultimate resource, right? The one resource you can't do without. Right. Every brain comes with two hands attached. Every stomach comes with two hands attached. Every mouth is backed by a creative intelligence that under the right circumstances will seek to improve their own lives and the lives of their families, and everyone will be better off as a result. So targeting people and the idea that that's going to create economic progress is the failed Malthusian idea that even the New York Times in its millennial edition back in 2000 published a millennial edition, and it listed the great myths of the 20th century. And one of the myths that it listed in the year 2000 was the myth of overpopulation. And yet we still have a population control movement funded to the tune of billions of dollars with tens of thousands of employees, which continues to propagate this failed myth. And, and people die as a result, sadly.
And the funding is coming largely from very wealthy individuals. And this is the point people don't get. It's coming from people like the Gates Foundation and Warren Buffett and George Soros, where would you put them all on the political spectrum? Politically, they wouldn't necessarily be all going for the same candidates. That's not the point. The point is population control is something that unites them in their view of the world. And then they've also gotten the governments involved, so that their taxpayer dollars involved, in addition to all of their personal wealth. They spend a lot of money influencing elections and lobbying and so on. Sorry, go ahead.
Yeah. I call them the billionaire boys club. There's something about having a billion or more dollars that leads you to look with disdain upon people who don't have that much money. These people think that a life lived with an annual income of less than $1 million is not a life worth living. Well, by that standard, all of us, are living lives that aren't worth living and should be eliminated from the face of the earth. But there's an arrogance in that. There's an elitism. There's a materialism there that leads them to look down on their fellow human beings and somehow be threatened by humanity in its numbers. And maybe these very wealthy people are very good at, mathematics. They understand the power of exponential growth. And I think they've been misled into thinking that humanity is breeding itself off the face of the planet. I mean, that's how you become wealthy, right? You understand the principle of compound interest, which is what Albert Einstein called the most powerful force in the universe. But as a practical matter, these people have no idea what is really important in human life. Love and relationships and society are what gives life meaning, not how much money you have in your bank account. But they've also leveraged, as you mentioned, the federal government into using our tax dollars into carrying out their program. That's why Bill Gates is very upset at the temporary cutoff in funding to the World Health Organization, because it turns out that while the United States is the largest donor to the World Health Organization, giving them $400 million a year, the Gates Foundation is the second largest donor to the World Health Organization, giving more money to the World Health Organization than China does, for example. And so Bill Gates is very unhappy that his money is not being matched by U.S. tax dollars in order to carry out the World Health Organization's plans, which include population control, which include abortion on demand everywhere in the world. So that's what they do. They leverage their own money into generous government funding by pulling the right political levers. It's something it's a business that most Americans wouldn't want to be involved in. If you do a survey of Americans and say, is it any of America's business how many children people have in, say, India or the Philippines? Most people will say no. That's not a proper concern of the United States. Only a minority will say yes. And yet, we, despite being a democratic country, have been funding population control programs since the late 1960s. When we set up, we made sure that the UN Population Fund was established in 1968, and we were the primary and most generous funder of it for decades until we at the Population Research Institute were able to get the funding cut off under President Reagan in the mid-1980s.
So you've opened several different avenues that I want to explore in the short time that we have together. And I'm sure people are going to be so interested in what you have to say that they're going to check out the Population Research Institute, which you can find at pop.org, P-O-P.org. Tons of good stuff. You're going to want to get Steve's old book and his new books and follow him on Twitter and so on. But there are two points I want to touch on. I'd like you to say a little bit about, in your opinion, the mishandling of the coronavirus, Wuhan virus, by the World Health Organization and the Chinese government. I want to talk about that. But I'd also like to talk about capitalism Chinese style. Because a few minutes ago, you were talking about what it takes to develop a country and what it takes to create wealth and so on and so forth. And yet China seems to be becoming a richer country. Their GDP is increasing and so on. So I'd like you to say a little bit about how they've accomplished that, because they're playing by a little bit different rules over there, as I understand it. So why don't you do that one first? Talk to us about the Chinese economy a little bit.
The Chinese Communist Party has been convinced for decades that it can basically steal and lie and cheat its way to the top of the global economy. And I pick those words deliberately. When I talk about stealing, I mean the theft of intellectual property from the United States. The FBI estimates $600 billion a year is stolen from the United States in terms of intellectual property. Over 10 years, that's $6 trillion. Over 20 years, that's $12 trillion. That's a handsome sum of money that they got basically for free, because cyber espionage can be done on the cheap. The other way they've stolen cutting-edge technology from Western companies is that every company that comes into China and wants a share of the Chinese market is forced to hand over their cutting-edge technology. Once they're squeezed dry of their technology, they're generally squeezed back out of the country by Chinese competition, subsidized by the Chinese Communist Party and supported by the Chinese state, which is able to produce the same goods using the same cutting-edge technology cheaper than the international company can, cheaper because they didn't have to pay any research and development costs. They simply stole, the government forced the company, the foreign company, to hand over the technology. Then you have the aspect of the selling of cheap consumer goods in North America and in Europe. violating the terms of the World Trade Organization, which required China to open up its consumer market in the same way that Western consumer markets were required to open up to Chinese goods. They liked the second half of the bargain. They didn't like the first. Their economy is still largely closed. Finally, there are no private companies in China. There's a massive pretense of private companies in China because they set up these front companies, these companies, in order to take advantage of Western laws governing private companies, private organizations. But every company in China is beholden to the party. Every company with more than 50 employees in China has to have a party cell. That is a group of Communist Party members who are in the organization and help to direct it politically. Every company in China with more than 50 employees has to have a party secretary serving on the board of directors of that company. Every high-tech company actually has to sell 1% to 10% of its stock to the Chinese Communist Party directly and have a senior member of the Communist Party sitting on its board of directors. So a company like Huawei, which has been in the news because it wants to set up 5G espionage networks all around the world, a company like Huawei is controlled by the Chinese Communist Party. So there are effectively no private enterprise companies, except for small mom-and-pop stores, which are really beneath the notice of the Chinese Communist Party. Any company of any size in China is either owned directly by the Chinese state, that's the case in more than half of these companies, or it's indirectly controlled by the party cell, the party secretary, and the party member of the board of directors. If I'm holding a board of directors meeting, I'm the chairman, and sitting at the opposite end of the table is the representative of the Chinese Communist Party, who has the final say?
Right.
Now the people who have the guns have the final say.
Right.
And so that's what we're dealing with. We're dealing with a kind of fascist economic organization where, like in Nazi Germany, the Nazis were content to leave the big companies in the hands of private entrepreneurs as long as the private entrepreneurs did the bidding of the Nazi party, because the Nazis understood that they were far better, the private entrepreneurs were far better producing guns, bullets, tanks, poison gas than they would ever be. And that's what the Chinese Communist Party is doing today. It calls itself communist, but it really runs a fascist organization, especially in economic terms. It is not a fair competition. It is not a level playing field for American companies, which simply cannot compete in China, because the Chinese Communist Party will play with the rules until the foreign company is driven out of the country.
Well, the other thing they do is that they have no regulations of the kind that we would have here. There's no minimum working standards. The environmental standards are all different, all of those type of things. So we're in compliance with all of these things that progressives in the United States, or so-called progressives, value, that they cherish, environmental protections and worker protections and so on. None of that's going on in China, and so therefore they can outcompete us on those grounds as well. Go ahead.
Labor cannot compete with serf labor. Chinese workers are not allowed to organize. They're not allowed to engage in strikes or lockdowns or slowdowns. If they do such things, the police are called out and they're put back in their place, beaten, and sometimes people have been shot in demonstrating for workers' rights in China. Workers in China have no rights. And so they work for a pittance. And now, to get the economy back up and running in China after as the coronavirus epidemic there winds down, they have been importing slave labor from the far west of China. The Uyghur Muslims are being sold in batches of 100 to factories along China's east coast in Shanghai, Zhejiang, Tianjin, Guangzhou, the big manufacturing areas, to make up for the workers and the Chinese workers in the villages who haven't come back to work because they're afraid of catching the coronavirus. This is slave labor, out and out slave labor. These workers who come in batches of 100 with their own police escorts, by the way, are kept in their own factory dormitories, not allowed out of the factory compounds, and forced to work long hours for almost no wages. And then in the evening, to make matters worse, they're forced to learn Chinese and forbidden to speak their own native language, which is Turkish.
So another aspect of this is that we keep referring to this as the Chinese Communist Party, and indeed that is their name. But many of my free market friends think, gee, it would be great if we just do business with China. They will become more capitalist. They will become more like us and so on. But the description that you're giving here is, in a sense, you could say that the economy in China is the worst nightmare stereotype caricature of capitalism, of being the rich exploiting the poor being wage slaves, people having no options, things being a complete interconnection between the government and the companies. You know, that is a reality in China. You know, that crony capitalism, what we might call crony capitalism, but is actually much worse than that. It's the nightmare scenario of Marxists, and yet Marxists around the world, are we deceived by labels? I mean, my capitalist friends think it's really capitalism, and the communist friends think it's really communist. But it isn't exactly either of those things when it gets down to it. It's just totalitarianism. Yeah. Yeah, totalitarianism using whatever label or tool happens to work at a given moment. That's what it seems like to me as a non-specialist.
Communism is a convenient cover story for the kind of system that the Chinese oligarchs have set up, and you know, we talk about a lot about oligarchs in Russia. There are 100 times more oligarchs in China than there are in Russia. Everyone in China, in the senior reaches of the Chinese Communist Party, going down to the middle reaches of the Chinese Communist Party, probably going down to county party secretaries, has become very wealthy from profiting off their job. The bribes, the kickbacks, the sweetheart deals are just incredible. Let me give you an example. The premier from 2002 to 2012 was a man named Wen Jiabao. Premier Wen Jiabao. And Premier Wen came into office with an undisclosed amount of money. By the time he'd left office on his salary of 5,000 yuan a month, he was worth $2.3 billion. $2.3 billion. How did he get $2.3 billion? Because people in China buy... People in China often buy their promotions. To get from, colonel to general, you have to pay 100,000 yuan. To get from one star to two star, you have to pay a certain amount of money. That's the way things work in China. Everybody profits from whatever state-owned corporation or company they happen to be in charge of. So there's a tremendous amount of corruption in China. That's why China is not will never be an innovation economy. They depend on stealing innovations from the West, particularly from the United States, in order to advance. And if we deny them access to our innovations, that economy will fall behind very quickly. In China, you would never innovate anything because it would simply be stolen by the party member who's in charge of your county or who's in charge of your prefecture or province. Or he'd come into your company and he'd say, "You're making a lot of money. I'd like to become your partner." And he's just made you an offer you can't say no to.
You really can't refuse this offer. That's right.
Or party officials will come in and say, "You know, I'd like to buy your company for 10 cents. And you say, "No, it's worth $10 million. And the local police chief is sitting right there. And so you sign over your company for whatever they're willing to pay you for it. I mean, the level of corruption and extortion and bribery is just unimaginable for those of us who live in the United States, where those things are the exception rather than the rule. In China, they're the rule rather than the exception. But communism, of course, commands a respectable audience in the West, from leftists and progressives of various stripes, who think, well, they can't be all bad. They're trying to build a perfect society.
Right. It's the dream world. The dream world.
Yeah.
And the appeal of that dream world provides cover for unimaginable crimes, really. And in a sense, the population control dream world is like that as well, right? That if you just give us enough power, we'll solve all these problems and there won't be any more poor children anymore.
We'll solve it all. Socialism is great. It's just that the wrong people have been in charge all along. If we're in charge, it'll all work out, right?
Right. And so I think sometimes that people are misled by the details of that dreamscape. You know, the sexual revolutionaries are promising a world where everyone can have all the sex they want and no one will ever even be inconvenienced by it. And some people are promising equality and some people are promising wealth, but it's all a dream. And behind, and to support the dream, you hand over all of your liberty and all of your cooperation, and you don't resist the way you should, and you're not suspicious the way you should be, and so on. They all have that in common. I want to take a moment, though, to take us back to the World Health Organization and its mishandling of the corona Chinese virus outbreak and their connection to China. How does it connect some of those dots for us, Steve?
Well, China has been on a long march through international institutions for decades. Ever since it joined the UN, it has sought to place its operators, its operatives, its apparatchiks in senior positions in various international organizations at the UN and elsewhere. Right now, the Chinese People's Republic of China citizens and members of the Chinese Communist Party, mind you, hold 4 of the 15 directorships of the 15 UN organizations. They also effectively control a couple of others because their candidates were elected to head those organizations. Dr. Tedros from Ethiopia was a PLA candidate, PRC candidate. They supported his election. Dr. Tedros originally is a member of the ruling junta in Ethiopia, which is basically a communist group. So he's their guy. The economy of Ethiopia has been tremendously bolstered by Chinese investment of various kinds, railroads, buildings, so forth. And so China owns Ethiopia. China, I would say, owns Dr. Tedros. That's why, for example, he completely continues to ignore Taiwan, which is the best example of a country which has stopped the China coronavirus epidemic in its tracks. And they did that because they recognized on December 29th or earlier that there was a new and dangerous viral pneumonia occurring in the city of Wuhan. And they warned, the Taiwan CDC warned the World Health Organization on December 29th. The World Health Organization ignored the warning. But Taiwan began to monitor people coming in from China and geared up for what was possible, another repeat of the SARS epidemic of 2003. In their view, from Taiwan's view, nothing good ever comes out of China. Mm-hmm. China constantly threatens to invade Taiwan, to take back Taiwan as a renegade province. The 23 million free people of Taiwan want nothing to do with mainland China and the Chinese Communist Party. On January 14th, the World Health Organization, Dr. Tedros, said there's no evidence of person-to-person transmission of the China coronavirus. That was contrary to all the evidence that had accumulated up to that point. You see, if you say there's no evidence of person-to-person transmission, then you don't have the possibility of a serious epidemic, certainly not a pandemic. You have a limited outbreak that's foodborne or waterborne or you know, passed from one person to another by body fluids, but it wouldn't reach ever pandemic status. I think they knew in China well before then that there was person-to-person transmission. They knew it back in December. But they told Dr. Tedros that there wasn't, and he propagated that lie to the world. So he was a willing dupe, useful fellow traveler for the Chinese Communist Party's cover-up. And then, of course, on January 23rd, China shut down the city of Wuhan, 14 million people, cut off rail and road and airline traffic in and out of the city to other parts of China. But it didn't stop flights from going from Wuhan and other Chinese cities to other places in the world. Why would it do that? Why would it, if it's quarantining the city of Wuhan against the spread of the virus in China, why would it enable the spread of the virus to other countries around the world? In late January, January 29th, Dr. Tedros went to Beijing to visit Xi Jinping for the first time. And Xi Jinping said, there's nothing to worry about. I'm in charge. Everything's under control. Dr. Tedros came out of the meeting grinning and said, there's nothing to worry about. China has it under control. And Xi Jinping is in charge. That was the day that Donald Trump, God bless him, put a moratorium on flights from China to the United States. He was roundly criticized for doing that by the World Health Organization, which for some reason wanted flights from China carrying infected people to come back to the United States and to other places around the world. But it was absolutely the right decision. The only country to act sooner than that was Taiwan, because, again, Taiwan is constantly on the alert where China is concerned. And they cut off air traffic from China the day after Wuhan was put under quarantine. And then they began distributing face masks, checking temperatures at the airport of travelers from other countries, handing out personal protective gear. They had all those things stockpiled because in 2003 they had been burned by the SARS epidemic, which again came from China, and China lied about. And fortunately, the SARS epidemic 2003 didn't reach the United States, but it reached Taiwan. And so Taiwan thought, this is going to happen again. We're ready. They put 168 different measures in place. They have very few infections. They have almost no deaths in Taiwan. The World Health Organization won't listen to them because China would be unhappy. So the World Health Organization is actually carrying water for China, and it has... By propagating China's cover story around the world, it has caused the pandemic that it was so reluctant to declare that it wasn't until February, the end of February, that the World Health Organization finally said, February 29th, finally said, yes, we've got a global pandemic on our hands. Should have been declared a month before. Person-to-person transmission should have been declared in late December. The first cases should have been identified in China in November. The World Health Organization should have been there then. People from the American CDC should have been there then. We would have found out what this was and stopped it in its tracks. None of that was done. The World Health Organization and China jointly own this pandemic. Everybody who dies from it, everybody who is sickened by it, everybody who loses business or a job from it is a victim of the Chinese Communist Party.
So review for me the date, because the dates that are sticking in my mind is, as a person in Louisiana, we have one of the highest numbers. You know, New York and Louisiana are among the top states for the outbreak. On February 25th of this year, we had Mardi Gras in New Orleans, where like a zillion people show up in Bourbon Street and so on. And that was February 25th. How soon did China know what was going on? How soon did the World Health Organization know what's going on? When could they have said there's a problem here and prevented the Mardi Gras from happening?
Well, China now admits the first case happened on November 1st.
Okay.
We know that November 1st of 2019. Okay. We know that the National Health Commission of China sent in late December a delegation down to Wuhan to find out what it could about this novel coronavirus that was causing this dangerous new pneumonia. So the central government of China knew about it in late December. We know that the Chinese doctors in Wuhan were warning their colleagues by December 29th. We know that because Dr. Li, the martyr to the cause of truth and transparency, who later died of the coronavirus, was arrested a day later for propagating rumors about a dangerous new pneumonia. He was merely telling the truth, but he was forced to write a confession before being released. We know the Chinese government on January 1st locked down its military bases in and around the city of Wuhan. That's 23 days before it quarantined the city of Wuhan. So it knew there was a dangerous new pneumonia about. The first thing it did was not try to find a cure. The first thing it did was not quarantine people suffering from the infection. The first thing it did was lock down its military bases so that the people with the guns on whom they depend to stay in power would not fall ill. That was their first concern, was the power and prestige of the Chinese Communist Party. So if China were a normal nation, governed by had a normal leader who was not interested in lying, deceiving the world, we would have known in late December that China had a problem, and we would have sent people in. We would have warned the world. There's an estimate from Great Britain that 95% of the infections in the world could have been stopped had we known in early January what we later found out from China.
And what we could have known.
That means that we now have 20 times the number of infections and probably 20 times the number of deaths that we would have had if China had behaved in the way that it's required by international law to behave, to be transparent about dangerous new pathogens, which can be carried across borders and cause problems in multiple countries. Because they lied, because China lied, people died. Yep. Because the WHO lied, people died. And they died unnecessarily, and there has to be a reckoning. China has to be held to account. The nations of the world, not just the United States, but the nations of the world have to demand reparations from China. They have to demand transparency from China. There are a number of things that I think we should be doing. For example, ending China's sovereign immunity, allowing people who have been harmed by the China coronavirus that China unleashed on the world to sue the Chinese government in American courts. And if they get a judgment, to collect on that judgment by seizing assets of the Chinese Communist Party, the Chinese government in the United States. I believe that the $1.1 trillion in debt that the Chinese government holds in U.S. Treasury bonds should be expropriated as a down payment on the trillions of dollars of loss that the U.S. economy has suffered. We shouldn't do that unilaterally. We should do that in conjunction with Australia, New Zealand, Great Britain, Spain, Italy, France, Germany, all the countries of the world that have suffered from the coronavirus. You know, how well do you think Boris Johnson, the Prime Minister of the UK, is after spending a week in the hospital because of the China coronavirus? And now Great Britain has the worst situation in Europe after Italy. How well disposed do you think the Spaniards are, the Czechs are, the Dutch are, after getting faulty PPE from China, faulty test kits from China?
Yes. Spell that out. Not everybody knows that. That's an amazing thing right there. Say it.
China exported to many European countries and to Australia faulty personal protective equipment and faulty test kits that produced false negatives and false positives. Well, if you have the coronavirus and you take one of these cheap Chinese tests and it tells you you don't have the coronavirus, you're going to go merrily about your way infecting others, so that the test is not going to help contain the disease. It's going to help spread the disease. Now, I'm not saying that's deliberate, but, you know, this is
China. But it's a fact. And it's happening. This is multiple countries, multiple reports of this.
Death by China. So I think we need to get to the bottom of where the coronavirus came from, and I'm convinced it came from the Wuhan Institute of Virology. We need to get together with our allies and all the injured countries around the world and take action against China. I believe this could be the end of China's dream of world domination. And, you know, if you want to imagine what the world would be like under Chinese domination, well, the world would be a sicker, poorer, less free place by far. I think a lot of people see that now who maybe didn't see that a few months ago.
Right. And when you think about the lives that could have been saved, just think about Chinese New Year celebration that took place in New York City, I believe in the beginning of February. That went off. And the mayor of New York, everybody said, oh, it's fine, it's great, right? That bit of misinformation is directly linked to the many deaths that have taken place in New York City. If we had had accurate information out of China and the HWO, that need not have happened. And likewise here in Louisiana with Mardi Gras, the huge gathering of people that takes place in a very small space. All of this is of a pattern of deception and self-aggrandizement on the part of the Chinese Communist Party that's gone back for decades, literally decades, starting with this issue that the Ruth Institute has been concerned about since the very beginning of our organization. And now finally, hopefully, people will be paying attention to China in a way that they haven't before. Steve, tell people about some of your more recent books and activities that people can get involved in. I really want Ruth Institute listeners to know that there's something they can do. So tell them about your book, and then let's give them something to do.
Well, the latest book is called Bully of Asia, and people can guess what the Bully of Asia is I'm talking about. It's, of course, the People's Republic of China under the misrule of the Chinese Communist Party. And in The Bully of Asia, I talk about how China's political system was totalitarian from the beginning. 500 years before the birth of Christ, China invented totalitarianism. Over 2,000 years before the birth of Vladimir Ilyich Lenin or Karl Marx, China had invented all of what we associate with modern Marxist-Leninism, concentration camps, political commissars, and so on and so forth. And unfortunately, the Chinese people, of course, are the first and foremost victims of the Chinese Communist Party. And there is The Bully of Asia on your Kindle.
There you go. Yeah, I was so eager to get it. I got it on Kindle. I couldn't wait for it to come in the mail.
The subtitle of which is Why China's Dream is a New Threat to the World Order. China's dream is the dream of world domination, that America will become a second or third tier country, that all manufacturing will move to China, and that the rest of the world will serve as a source of food and raw materials for China's industrial machine, and of course, consumers for made in China products. That's China's dream, and that's the dream that we cannot let become reality. I'm following the China coronavirus pandemic on Twitter. I finally opened a Twitter account reluctantly. I'm at Stephen W. Mosher. So I post the latest on what's happening in China and around the world on Twitter at Stephen W. Mosher.
Pop.org. People should definitely go to the Population Research Institute, pop.org. Do you guys also maintain the site called Overpopulation is a Myth?
We do. We publish news and information. We have entertaining and educational YouTube videos on populationisamyth.com that are very good. You can show them to elementary school kids, high school kids. They're entertaining, and they make it clear that people are not the problem.
Right.
People are not the problem. There's no overpopulation problem on planet Earth. There's plenty of room on God's green earth for all of us if we simply manage the resources that we've been given properly. There's no need to go about wantonly reducing the human population. And China, to end with one final word about China, China's limited to 400 million people from its population and now has a dying population. The largest country in the world is seeing its population now shrink from year to year. The population is aging, the workforce is shrinking, and they're desperate to get the birth rate up. They would have been better off if the geniuses who run the Chinese Communist Party would have been better off if they'd simply left well enough alone, but they didn't. They engaged in population control, which is always a mistake.
Right, right. Now, is there anybody people should be writing to or any causes people should be involved in besides following you guys on pop.org? Is there anything particular going on that you would recommend that people get involved with?
Well, I have been opposed to funding population control programs for almost my entire adult life because you don't eliminate poverty by eliminating people. You don't solve environmental problems by eliminating people. You don't jumpstart economic development by eliminating people. What you do is you create massive human rights abuses. And by focusing on population control, you cause deaths from other causes to rise, right? If we take all of our medical resources and devote it to stopping the China coronavirus, we're going to see deaths from heart attacks and strokes, right, cancer go up. So there is an opportunity cost to focusing all of our medical resources on something like population control. Back in Peru, when the entire medical establishment of the country of Peru was busily sterilizing hundreds of thousands of Peruvian women, they had a malaria epidemic. They had rising rates of typhus and typhoid and other preventable diseases. Why? Because the doctors and nurses who should have been attending to those problems were off doing sterilizations under government orders and following government quotas. So there's always an opportunity cost. So we have to understand that population control programs kill in that way as well, by taking resources away from solving problems like clean drinking water, typhus, typhoid, malaria, yellow fever, and so forth.
Well, Stephen Mosher, I wish you were Dr. Stephen Mosher. In my heart, you're Dr. Stephen Mosher. Thank you so much for being with us and the Ruth Institute viewers. I know people are going to be blessed by what you've had to say here.
Well, thank you for that promotion. And after all, it's when, what's in our heart that ultimately matters anyway.
Thank you very much, Steve.
Thank you.
Joyful, joyful Lord, we adore thee, God of glory, Lord of God.
Stephen Mosher wrote, "Churches torn down or denuded of their crosses and statues, images of the Madonna and Child replaced with pictures of Communist President Xi Jinping, signs posted outside churches forbidding anyone under the age of 18 from entering, the Ten Commandments painted over with quotes from Xi Jinping, one of China's largest evangelical places of worship blasted with dynamite by Communist police and demolished. Believers suffer arrest, imprisonment, and in some cases torture. One pastor, for example, has just been sentenced to 9 years in prison. Mosques torn down and ancient cemeteries leveled. Buddhist temples turned into shrines celebrating Xi Jinping. His picture adorns the walls. His recorded voice booms out of the loudspeakers. And it is his thought, not Buddha's, that Buddhist monks are now required to meditate upon. Taoist temples that have stood for over 1,000 years closed and ancient statues smashed. Laws order Christians and all religious groups to propagandize the principles and policies of the Chinese Communist Party. Without the permission of the Communist government, you can't organize a Bible study. And if you do get permission, you must hold it in a party-approved venue, at a party-approved time, with a party-approved leader, and using the new party-approved Bible, which contains quotations from Confucius and President Xi Jinping." One law summarizes, "Religious groups must also report to the appropriate government authorities any and all other matters that should be reported." In other words, we can shut you down at any time for any reason. These are just some of the ways that the Chinese Communist Party practices religious persecution. Now for the most important part of our program, your action item for this week. Read Stephen Mosher's books, such as Bully of Asia and Population Control and A Mother's Ordeal. Join the Population Research Institute. Donate $20 and get Bully of Asia free. Like the Population Research Institute on Facebook. Follow Steve Mosher on Twitter. Check out Overpopulation is a Myth on Facebook. And that's our action item for this week.
Praise God. Amen. You may be seated.
Right after I was born, the local officials came and ordered my mom to be sterilized. For the past 3 decades, everyone in my family had to apply for permission from the government to have a child. I know how strong that message was. It was everywhere around myself when I grew up. It was printed on the matches, playing cards, textbooks, posters. The one-child policy was everywhere around us, and so were the threats against disobeying it. The midwife who delivered all of the babies born in my village, including myself, was 84 years old when I interviewed her. She said she had performed 60,000 forced abortions and sterilizations. Sometimes, she said, a late-term fetus would survive an abortion, and she would kill the baby after delivering it. She remembered how her hands would tremble as she did the work.
You've been listening to the Dr. J Show, a production of the Ruth Institute. The Ruth Institute equips Christians to defend the family and build a civilization of love. Check out our website at ruthinstitute.org for helpful resources and support. Join us on Facebook. Our podcasts can also be found online at ruthinstitute.org.